Hi everyone, my name is Felix. I am the CEO and co-founder of Backend, and it's my pleasure to talk about a topic that I personally think might be very important for the future of the web. So we're going to talk about service workers, which is the technology behind progressive web apps. So what we're going to cover is, first of all, we're going to look into what this paradigm of progressive web apps is actually about. So what are the building blocks? How do you actually implement it? And then we'll move forward to the underlying technology, Service Worker, which allows you to build progressive web apps. We look into the life cycle, how you intercept the network, how you cache, all these kind of low-level things on how to achieve a progressive behavior. And lastly, we're going to look into some small use cases of how we use Service Workers, because since we heavily rely on it, we've pushed them quite to the maximum that you can currently do in browsers. So let me start with what do we love or what don't we love about native apps. So first of all, a great thing about native apps is you always have them on your home screen, so they're easily accessible. You have app stores where you can find all these different native apps. Typically, they load quite fast because all of the data that you need for displaying it is packaged into an installable bundle. They work offline, usually, in most cases. At least you can achieve it. You can use all the native phone APIs like geolocation, camera, and so on. And you can receive push notifications, which is an important way to kind of re-engage with your users. But there are also quite a few weak points. So when you look at it, you need an installation process, which is quite a big entry barrier. They're not cross-platform in most cases. There's a tedious release and update process where your package needs to be checked by Apple or Google. And then there's also the problem that some users tend to not update their apps, which means you have to deal with multiple versions. So when you evolve your APIs in the background, you always have the problem of do you support older versions of your app or not. So the idea of progressive web app really boils down to combining the best from native apps and web apps. So how do we do that? So first of all, what is a progressive web app? Let's talk about its properties. So first of all, what it tries to achieve is it wants to be as fast as your native apps. So it wants to load fast, and you can do that by caching. It has an offline mode, which means that even though your network might be temporarily inaccessible, like in this room, for example, for my mobile network, you can still serve your users with useful data. And then you have mechanisms that are very similar to native apps. You can add your web app to the home screen, and you can send push notifications. So here's an example of a progressive web app. Our company website is actually a progressive web app. So here's a small demo of what this means when you use it. So first of all, what you might notice is that the browser can decide if you're on that site not for the first time or have been browsing there for a while, it might decide to add you to the home screen. So that's not up to you as a developer, but that's up to the browser who thinks you might find it useful to add it to the home screen. And then you have it there. And once you click on it, you can actually define the behavior of how your app loads. In this case, we had a splash screen, and we also do not have the top browser bar, which means we have full screen. And then, this is basically a browser where your web app runs in. But the interesting thing is that when you switch off the network, so you go into flight mode and disable mobile data, you actually can continue to browse on the site, simply because there's a service worker in the background that has cached the data that we're seeing here, and therefore you don't need a network in order to see that. So how do we build that? The advantages of PWAs, so short for progressive web apps, have been very nicely summarized by Mozilla, who say, okay, what do we actually want to achieve with this? Because since, like many other technologies, progressive web apps aren't actually that new. Service workers have been around for a while, but they were missing a sticky term. Like, for example, XML HTTP requests only become successful when it was reframed as AJAX. So this is kind of the thinking framework for what PWAs are. So first of all, they are discoverable because there's just open web standards, and you can use links, so you can find them on search engine and not just in an app store. They're installable, which means you can access them from the home screen. They are linkable. They use regular URLs. You can link into a progressive web app, which is much harder in native apps. They are network independent, so when your network goes offline, you can continue using them. They are progressive, which means they do not require to use the newest browser, but when you have it, they will start enhancing your experience. Re-engageable, which means you can kind of get back users that have not been using you for a while by sending them notifications through web push. Responsive, they want to fit any form factor, so no matter whether tablet or mobile device. And they are safe, so they require the use of HTTPS and the use of recognizable URLs, so you always know where you are and that that is actually a safe place. So I think the best quote to characterize this is from Alex Russell from Google, who said, these apps aren't packaged and deployed through stores, they are just websites that took all the right vitamins. So let's look into the vitamins. The building blocks of PWAs basically are two things. On the one hand, we have the web app manifest, which defines how you edit to the home screen. And then you have, on the other hand, the service worker that controls all the application logic. So there, your JavaScript code sits that actually defines how your progressive web app functions. And PWAs aren't one standard. They're just a set of open web standards. So service worker is one of them, web push, and so on. This is just an umbrella term for all of these. And the progressive name, of course, stems from when you have service workers in your browser, so you're using an up-to-date browser, you get them, and when you do not have them, it kind of fails down, or it kind of degrades to a version that is still usable, but does not have the nice features of a progressive web app. So let's look into the manifest. The manifest is very simple. You have basically a link header in your HTML, where you have a JSON file that you reference, and in that JSON file you can define what is my icon in the different resolutions, how do I want my app to behave when I start it, so for example, what does the splash screen look like, and do I want it to be in full screen mode, or do I want to have a browser bar. You can define all that in the manifest, so it's actually quite simple. And there's convenient tools to actually build these without using JSON. And then the second part, service workers, they basically sit between your browser and between the network. So what they can do is they can intercept any request that the browser makes and change its behavior. So for example, when you're offline, it can decide to serve you from the cache instead of getting the request over the network. And apart from that, it also has kind of background capabilities. For example, it can receive push notifications, and it also can do something called background sync, which is, for example, very useful when you do something offline. Let's say you write an email and want to submit it, and then you do not have the network, but later on you might have it, so in the background it can be transferred. The typical kind of web application architecture that you use was termed by Google. It's called the App Shell model, and it's actually very similar to what any single-page application framework does. You basically split your application up into two parts, the one with all the assets and the basic structure, and then the dynamic data that you get. So the part that is called the app shell is all your HTML, CSS, and JavaScript that defines your application logic, and then you have the kind of data that fills it, and that is the content that you get on demand. And the reason for the split is actually that you can cache the app shell very well, so you always have this kind of basic layout, and then only the content needs to be fetched over the network. So before we go into we implement these, let's talk about what is kind of on the horizon for progressive web apps, because there's a lot of interesting stuff happening there. So for example, there's the web payments API being standardized, and I put the browser support there on the top. It's actually very good at this time already. And what they try to do there is they want to have a native payment experience that you do not have to re-implement every time you build a checkout process. So they want you to have a checkout process in just 10 lines of code. And the way this is achieved is that you get this kind of native view for doing a checkout, and then you have different APIs for the payment service provider and the client side, and then basically there's a standardized protocol in order to handle the checkout, so no need for implementing custom things like PayPal or Stripe. Then there's an API called the Credentials Management API, which allows you to kind of manage your different identities directly natively in your browser. So for example, it remembers your last login, and it can kind of revalidate your tokens in the background to make sure you're always logged in. So it's much more convenient than all these different looking forms where they behave very differently across different sites. Then there's a special case of geolocation called geofencing. So for example, in a smart home application, you might want to build a progressive web app that switches on your lighting when you get near your home. So in order to do that, you need some mechanism to inform your progressive web app in the background. And that's what is being worked on in the geofencing standard. Then conversational interfaces are quickly building up. So the web speech API leverages the browser natively to register commands and then lets you register kind of the reaction to that. So for example, this is a small framework around this web speech API where you could teach it to anytime you say, hello, Code Talks, the browser will do the speech processing and then call your callback and do something useful. And then sharing has always been a problem for web apps because you cannot actually share content between native apps and web apps. And therefore, there's a web share API where you can register both as a target for sharing. So let's say you build a PDF viewer in the browser. You can share your PDF documents into your progressive web app. And you can also do the other thing around. So you can share your PDF from your progressive web app into a native app. So let's talk about service workers. How do they work and how do we leverage them for building progressive web apps? So when we look at the browser, we typically have different browser tabs for the same website, and then we have the network, and in between sit service workers. So when you have two instances of the same page open in your browser, you actually only have one service worker. And service workers are very similar to web workers in that they are a decoupled background process running JavaScript code, and they are not directly related to one single tab. So the best definition is that they are a programmable network proxy running as a separate background process without any DOM access. So you cannot manipulate the page directly, but you can manipulate the network. So what can you do with that? So first of all, the most straightforward use case is that you can cache data. So when you see a request and you know it will be asked in the future again, so for example, for your app shell, you can cache that request. You can store even structured data. So there's IndexedDB that you have access to in your service worker. You can store relational data or other forms of data there. You can receive push notifications. You can respond when the user is offline. You can intercept HTTP requests. So for example, in the previous talk, we saw how we can kind of mock the browser to comprehend an image format that it's not natively understanding. You can have those behaviors in the service worker. You can sync data in the background, like in the email example. And you can even hike the dreaded Li-Fi. So when you think you have a Wi-Fi, but it's actually lying, you can hide that from the user in order to give them a better experience. So what's the current browser support for service workers? It's looking quite good right now. And I think the browsers that do not have it right now will never get it. So for example, Internet Explorer is the only kind of major browser that still has a lot of users that does not have it. All the other vendors have jumped on it, most recently Safari. And yeah, when you look at the coverage, it's roughly 85% of all users. There's one important thing about service workers. You always have to use TLS. So there's no service worker for an unencrypted website. And that's not a technical decision. It's more like we want HTTPS to be broadly used. So let's prescribe that service workers cannot be used without them. So it's a trick for driving adoption of TLS. Interesting thing about Microsoft, they are late but all in. So they adopted service workers, and they even use it for being listed on their store. They have a tool called PWA Builder, and what they do is they can crawl websites that are actually correct PWAs, and then they convert that to their model that they can list in their Microsoft store. So you get the classic App Store model combined with a normal web app that is kind of findable on the web. In order to use service workers, you first need to register them. And this is done by from JavaScript calling a register call with your file that has the logic of the service worker. So you shouldn't do it like this. You should first do a feature detection because it's not available in all browsers. But when you do this, it will register the service worker, start downloading it, parse it in the background, and then it will become active later. And it does not become active immediately, but instead it has a kind of complex life cycle that it goes through in order to manage what happens when different service workers are active. So The lifecycle basically is the first thing that is fired as an event is the install event, which happens when the browser fully passed the service worker and initialized it. So you get the you get this callback here in order to do things like cache my initial working set of data. So for example, my app shell. And that is done before the service worker is actually active. So you can do all the initialization logic before anything is handled by the service worker. And then there's an in-between step, the activation, because you can have multiple installed service workers. So for example, when you have an old service worker and you deployed a new version, there will be an active old service worker that is still handling the page, but the other service worker can be installed in the background, can already be in this installed state. And then only when the last tab is closed where the old service worker is active, then the new service worker picks up, and then this activate event is fired. And then the most important thing is the fetch event. So whenever any HTTP request is fired, you can intercept that and you can decide how to handle this request. And you can actually only do it for HTTP, so there's no support for other protocols like WebSockets or WebRTC. You are limited to HTTP, which covers most of the use cases. So when the service worker is in this idle state, it's always kind of woken up by an event like message or push. So when you want to communicate with the service worker, it's exactly the same way as it does behave when you send a fetch request. So when your browser tabs wants to communicate with it, there's a post message API that is also asynchronous. So you can register inside the service worker to be notified on events. And then from your main thread in your main JavaScript, you can call something like get me the client and post a message to this client. So it's an asynchronous message passing, very similar to web workers. The other way to get in contact with them is through a push service, and we're going to talk a bit about that later. And it basically works like native push with the major difference that the push service is managed by the browser vendor. So each browser has a kind of push endpoint, and that push endpoint is for all applications. So that's how you register for a push event. You have an event listener. And the interesting thing about that is, even though your browser might be closed, you might not have any tab open, and just the idle Chrome process is running somewhere in the background, it will still handle this call here. When you receive a push message, it will call your code and evaluate the message. And you can decide, for example, to show it or to manipulate it or whatever. So when you want to intercept network requests, you have to hook into the fetch event. And what happens then is that you can manipulate the request and the response. So let's walk through a little example here. Let's say we have a request here. We want to get the URL. And then based on the event that we get passed in, we want to do this here. We create a new request, so a second request, that has the same URL, but we replace the .com top-level domain by .de. And then what we do is we fire this request. And by the way, this is this all ES6 with newer features and like a wait. And you can all do that in service workers, because all the browsers that support service workers have all the new ES6 and ES8 features. And yeah, so in this case, we wait for the response to await. And we get the response text, so the body. And in the body, we replace some string. And then we pass that back as a new response to the caller. So for the website itself, it looks like it had put the request against a totally different URL. And we even manipulated the content. So this is extremely powerful. And there's many things you can do with that. You can rewrite requests like we did here. You can change responses. You can concat responses. So when you have, for example, many files that you want to concatenate into one single response, you can do that. You can cache the response if you can serve cache data, and so on. A very important and often misunderstood concept of service workers is scope, because scope determines which requests you can see as a service worker. So the default is that the scope of the service worker is basically the top-level path under which it was included. So if you include it like slash path dot swjs, then the scope will be slash path. So you can only handle requests that start with slash path. And anything that is out of scope will bypass the service worker, and you will never see the request. And that's an important concept if you want to, for security reasons, restrict which parts of the site the service worker can see. And you can always limit scope, so you can pass a parameter in order to actually make the scope smaller than it would naturally be. But you can never expand scope. So when you have your service worker sitting in path slash SWJS, you can never handle the scope of slash top level. Persistence in the service worker is handled in different ways. You know, from the browser, you have things like session storage and local storage and so on. Those APIs are not supported because they are synchronous, and therefore only a few of these persistence APIs are supported, most importantly, IndexedDB and the service worker cache storage. So let's start with IndexedDB. IndexedDB is an actual database in the browser, typically backed by an SQLite in the implementation of the browser. It stores data persistently, and it can structure the data. So you can tell it, okay, this is my field XY, and it knows kind of the structure of the data, even though it allows semi-structured data. So a bit like a MongoDB, for example. And it is not just a dumb key-value store. It also supports limited range queries, so you can have efficient lookups in the data. And it has very good browser support. Any browser that has service workers also has IndexedDB. Let's talk about background sync. I put an experimental flag on the top because currently it's only supported in Chrome, but the other vendors have already started implementing it because it's very powerful and useful. There's two ways of doing a background sync. There's the one-off sync and there's the periodic sync. The one-off sync is basically handling an action that was triggered while you were offline and you want to repeat it in the background. So when the user gets back online, you can, for example, save a file when you're online again, or you can send an email when you're online again. So it's a one-time action that is retried once you have the network. With periodic sync, you can keep your app up to date. So let's say you build a social media-like web application and you want your news stream to always be updated. Then you can set up a periodic sync where you always, let's say in 15-minute intervals, crawl the newest data for your timeline for the user. And then when the user actually opens up your web app, you will have the newest data directly there. So it's very powerful, and browsers have some rate limits on what you can do in the background, because obviously you could abuse that for running all kinds of computations in the background. So you shouldn't overdo it, but it's very powerful for a fast first load experience, because when you fire up the app, you will have all your data there and do not need to contact the network at all. One important thing, and I will show that in the demo afterwards a bit, is how you debug service workers. Because as with any JavaScript, it's very hard to just write it and have it being correct. So there's fortunately very good support in Chrome. So you have in the application tab, you have things like you can look into your web app manifest for the progressive web app part. You can see your service worker. Here we have one service worker registered for backend.com. This is this hashed file here. You can see its current state, so it's activated and running, which means that it will intercept all the fetch requests that it sees. And you can even test things like push notifications and background sync. You can manipulate the lifecycle, so you can force the service worker to unregister or update. And there's all kinds of buttons up there. You can tell it to be bypassed when there's a network connection. You can force it to be reloaded, because by default it will only reload every 24 hours. And then on the bottom here, you have cache storage, which is the service worker cache. And you can look into all the files that you have stored there. You have access to IndexedDB, WebSQL, the both kind of the persistence standards that you can use there. And then you even have the debugger, which means you can go into your service worker file and you can register breakpoints and then, for example, jump into what is called when you do a fetch event. So let's talk about this cache storage, because that's a major abstraction in the service worker that completely replaces the browser cache. Replacing is a bit exaggerated, because you will have two caches, which is quite complicated in some cases, but it's a major mechanism. In order to be offline, you need to use the service worker cache. And the service worker cache is actually quite simple. It's a programmatically managed persistent key value store that stores pairs of requests and responses. So it's not like a key value store in the sense that you can put any type of data in it. It's very focused towards storing requests and responses. And in contrast to the browser cache, it's also not expiring. So all these cache control headers that you know from HTTP that tell the browser for how long a resource is cacheable in the browser cache, they do not work in the service worker cache because the service worker cache is persistent forever. So you put data in there and it remains there until you programmatically remove it from there. So there's no kind of automatic mechanism that maintains your cache. You have to manage it in your application. And it only caches GET requests, so no POST or other requests, and even not reading requests like a HEAD request. So you basically have one method where you say, match this request against your cache, and then it will give you a response. And there's different caching strategies that have evolved that have different purposes that we can quickly go through. So the easiest one is cache only, which means that when you see a fetch event, you will try to get it from the local service worker cache. And if you do not have it, you fail. Might seem a bit dumb, but it's actually useful when you have an application that is completely offline capable and has not does not have any functionality that needs the network, then you can use this pattern here. A bit more useful, cache network fallback means that you request the data from the cache, and when you do not have it in the cache, you use the network as a fallback. So that kind of iteratively fills the cache up, so when you do not have the data in the first place, you will have it later. Then you have network only, which is what happens when you hit the box in the DevTools. So basically, all the requests will go through the service worker cache and directly get to the network. Then network cache fallback is actually the opposite of what we saw before. We first try to get the request from the network, and if that fails, probably because we do not have a network, then the cache acts as a fallback and we get, for example, the last seen version of the data. Cache then network is the other way around, so we first get the data from the cache, and even if we have it and it does not fail, we get the data from the network in the background, which means that we have a very fast response and we make sure that the second time we call the data from the cache, it's already updated because we asynchronously refetched the data. So this is a good strategy to aggressively cache but still maintain some form of staleness prevention in your cache because you always refetch the data and put it back in the cache. But the major challenge with all these strategies is that you basically have to manage the cache by yourself. And that is not very easy because let's say you have cached your social media timeline and then some user posts an update. And what happens there is you do not have any kind of channel that goes back into your service worker and tells it, okay, this piece of data is outdated. So either you have to kind of refresh it every time, which makes the cache quite useless, or you have to implement a custom caching strategy, which is very complicated. And this basically brings me to what we do with service workers and a few use cases we can talk about, because we want to prevent this kind of behavior where you have stale data in your cache and you have to use the older version of the data because you do not know what the actual state of your application is. So what is the problem we tackle with service workers? It's actually quite simple because when you have a user visiting a website, you always have backend processing, you always have network delays, and we want to get rid in the ideal case of both of them. And what we do with SpeedKit is we have a service worker that sits inside the browser and it tries to rewrite all the requests that are slow. So it uses this fetch API in order to register to certain requests that are slow, and it rewrites them to a different CDN domain in order to accelerate them. So basically, when the user accesses yourdomain.com, the service worker will actually rewrite that domain to a CDN-backed domain, and by that it can take care of cache consistency. So I'll go into that in a bit, but what we do there is we maintain a data structure that tells the service worker cache which data is up to date and which data is outdated. So here's how it works in more detail. Let's say we have the website here and it has implemented this JavaScript snippet where it includes the service worker. So this feature detection, is there a service worker, and then register the service worker. That will initialize the service worker in the background. And then when we see a request, we can, for example, decide, okay, this looks like a tracking or advertising request. We do not want to manipulate that and we'll just pass it through. That's the easiest case. But then there's the interesting case of requests that would normally go to, let's say, a slow Magento or Shopware backend. And then we can decide to rewrite that request in order to get it faster. And that's what SpeedKit does. It kind of manipulates the request there. And then we update in the background all the data from the original backend and always serve the request through the service worker from our backend. So why do we do that? Let's talk about a few service worker use cases here. So one interesting thing that you can do with service workers, you can completely manipulate what kind of data you get from the URL you have been requesting. So one interesting use case for that is that when you have an application that did not optimize images, you can do that on the fly. So let's say we have a device that has a resolution of 640 pixels, and you request a very large JPEG file. And we know that this JPEG file is much too large for the browser to be meaningfully displayed. And what we can do then is we can decide in the service worker to put a request that says, OK, I'm a device that has a resolution of 640 pixels in width, and I understand WebP as a format, so please give me an image that suits better. And basically what we can do then is we can manipulate the request and serve a different image. So basically doing responsive images on the fly by leveraging the service worker for using information about the browser that we would not have on the server side normally. So that's quite useful for images. Then another interesting use case, what service workers can do is they can manipulate third-party resources. So let's say you host the service worker on mydomain.com and you include a JavaScript from, let's say, Facebook SDK, Google Analytics, and you have some images from an Amazon API. And then what normally happens is that the browser will establish a TCP connection first to all of these different domains, then it will do a TLS handshake, which typically takes 2 round trips, and will have to do DNS beforehand. So you have a very long kind of dead phase before you can put a request against any of these backends before something useful happens. And but with service workers, you can actually manipulate what happens there, because what you can do is you can say, OK, this is a request for Google Analytics JS, and I know this file is moderately cacheable. So what I do is I rewrite it to a different domain that I already have an open connection to, and then I request it from there. And for the browser, it looks like it has requested Google Analytics, but in the service worker, we actually went to a totally different domain or URL. And then the last thing about the cache coherence, how do we do it? It's actually research work out of the University of Hamburg. So there's a small trick that we leverage to know whether things in the service worker cache are still up to date or need to be refreshed. And it basically works like this. So with normal caching, you deliver your file via HTTP. You do a time to live attached to it. So for how long is this cacheable? And then you store it for that time. But as we saw before, when someone else changes the data, your time to live is basically useless because it was wrong and the data is already outdated. So what we do in that case is we can update the CDN and we can hash the URL into a data structure called Bloom Filter, which is a probabilistic representation of a set, so it knows what items are in it, but it has a small error probability, a false positive rate. And this kind of property that makes it a bit imprecise, it also what makes it extremely compact. So Bloom filters are very small compared to the number of elements that you can store in it. And for that reason, you can basically send it to the user without any overhead. So in the service worker, before you have issued the request, you make a lookup into the service worker asking, for this URL, have I seen that before? Meaning, is it in the browser cache and might be outdated because someone else updated it? And if that is so, let's post the request differently, which is as a revalidation request. So an HTTP revalidation basically tells the browser to do an if non-modified or if non-matched request that only gets the new data via HTTP if it has changed in the meantime based on the version number or the etag or the last modified date. So by that, you can bypass the service worker cache and always have the newest data in there. And that kind of use case was basically impossible 2 years ago because the normal browser cache is not accessible by any programmatic API. So you have no access to manipulating anything that is inside the browser cache. So only by having service workers as a very powerful programmable proxy, you can do a thing like this. Yeah, and then the last use case is Webpush. So Webpush is a bit complicated in detail if you implement it, because the way it works is that your server has a pair of keys, a public and a private key, called WebHit keys, that it registers with the push service of the browser. And you have to manage these key pairs in a way that allows users to subscribe. So here we saw, let me go back. So here we saw a request that asked for permission to send push notifications. And in that case, your application sends the public key. Let me pause it. Damn it. So it sends the public key of your application to the push service and says, OK, I want to register to updates for this. And then you can send it programmatically push notifications that will be triggered in the service worker in the push event, and you can handle that. So there's quite a lot you can do in push notifications. You can have things like polls, you can have images, you can link to things. So in this case, let's do a very simple push notification here with a title and a message, and then we attach to it a small survey with one action, and that action can have a URL. And that basically from the server sends a push notification to the web push service, and that contacts the service worker, triggers a notification there. So yeah. Let's look into a small demo of how service workers look in the browser. So let's hope my network is still there. So this is a e-commerce site you might have seen. It's Bower, developed by the Empiricum guys that are also here, and it uses a service worker, SpeedKit, which rewrites requests. So first of all, when you work with service workers, how do you detect them? When you look in into the waterfall of your application, what you will notice there is that you will see in the size column a from service worker. And that's actually the only real way to detect whether the request was handled natively by the browser network or by the service worker. And the request still looks like a normal request, but it was piped through the service worker and actually rewritten in the background. So as a user, you will not notice that actually the request went against a different domain in the background where they were rewritten to, because that is all hidden behind the interface of the service worker. And this is the application tab that we saw before, where you can manipulate the service workers, look into how they work. So let's open up the service worker. So here you have all the code. Let's pretty print that. And you could, for example, go into your fetch message, register a breakpoint there, and then anytime a request is called, you would basically have all the debugging options for handling that. And what's also quite useful is you can look into the state of your application. So you can look into the cache. Here we have a few cached responses. So here are some images. Here, for example, as we talked before, here's a JPEG image that is actually a WebP image because the service worker changed the type of data that was delivered there. And you can also use it for storing metadata. So here we have a separate cache. So you can create an arbitrary number of caches in your service worker that are all managed separately. And you can, for example, maintain metadata there, so as this Bloom filter. And then you have access to all the other storage media here. And you can, for example, unregister your service worker or update it. And one very interesting thing is you can go offline. So basically, this is what happens when you have no network connection at all. And then you can go into some area of the site. And if you have already been there before, all the data will come from the service worker. And even though we're completely offline, try that with a different side. So here we are still online. Let's try that to load that again. And you will get the typical result here. And in this case, we didn't get it because the service worker handled all the fetch requests and simply got them from the cache instead of the network. Okay, so since we do not have a lot of time, let me quickly go to the last part. You can look up in the slides. I have a bit on how you measure performance of progressive web apps, but let's come to the summary. What are progressive web apps? I think they're a very, very cool way to finally overcome native applications, because as a web developer, I've always been annoyed by that there's separate technologies for all the different platforms. And actually, we have nice standards on the web that we can use. And PWAs do exactly that. Service workers are extremely powerful. You can change anything that your application does in the service worker. And this is also one reason why, which I did mention before, a service worker has always to be hosted on the site that it interacts with. So when you have your domain.com and you want to have a service worker, you cannot include it from a CDN domain like a jQuery. You always have to host it on your site in the path of your domain. So because otherwise you would have full control over the website, which would be extremely dangerous. Yeah, and then we saw a few use cases about service workers, what you can do with it to build a kind of smart CDN. If you want to learn more about this, we have a very long blog post about service workers. And here we also have a bit of recommended literature, because as progressive web apps as a term are still quite new, there's not so much good material out there. There's one extremely good book, which is this one here by Tel Arter. It goes into both the details of how you build it and where the whole thing is going, and these books are okay, but I'd rather read that one. And there's a few blogs, and actually the best online material is by Google Developers and MDN, where they have very comprehensive guides on how to build that. Yeah, and last notice, we have two other talks here at the Code Talk. So if you want to learn more about these topics or topics that are related to it, we have a talk on WebAssembly later on, and we have a talk on real-time data processing. Yeah, and that's it. If you have any questions, I'm happy to take them. Thank you. So the question was, when you intercept a request and you see things like passwords, how can you make sure that they are not stolen? And that's very important, because this is actually the reason why you always have to include the service worker on the same domain, because then you have the assumption that it's your service worker and not the service worker from someone else, because you have full access to the cookies and other data, like, let's say, GET parameters. You can see session tokens, anything that is inside the request, you can see and manipulate that. There's a small exception there. So when you have requests going to third-party domains, it's a normal CORS request, so cross-origin resource sharing. And all the normal techniques for CORS that you know from single-page applications, they all apply there too. So you cannot do anything there. But all the requests that go to your own backend, you can do anything with this, including stealing passwords. So you better make sure that the service worker that is deployed on your site is actually safe and tested, and it's your service worker. Yes. That's a good question. There's two things you can do. The way that we currently do is we tell them to update the service worker, or we have a plugin that does it automatically for WordPress, for example. But there's also a second way that service workers support, which is you can have an import script statement. So in your service worker, you can make a call that fetches some JavaScript code, and that is directly embedded into your service workers. So there's two problems with that approach. So the first one is you prolong the installation process of the service worker. So you have to do one additional request in order for your service worker to initialize. And the second thing is the update mechanism of the service worker. So the way that the browser checks whether the service worker has been updated is not some version number or anything. What it does, it downloads the new service worker and then does a bytewise comparison of the old version with the new version. So let's say you have an import script with speedkit minus newest.js, then it wouldn't detect that there's actually a new version, because bytewise they look the same and the included content is never seen by the browser. So you have to make sure that there's an update mechanism beside that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's actually the same for all these storage mechanisms. So the browser has a quota both on the IndexedDB and your service worker cache, which means that when you use too much storage, so that depends totally on the browser implementation, so there's no standard for that, it might decide to kill your cache. And in contrast to the browser cache, which is basically using a cache replacement strategy to kind of keep the most used items in the cache, that's not happening in the service worker. The service worker cached is completely wiped. So when you get garbage collected by the browser, you will not have some inconsistent cache state, but instead you will basically start with a fresh cache as if the service worker was newly installed. Okay, yeah, one last question. Because local storage has a synchronous API, so when you call localstorage.get for a key, you get a synchronous response. And the idea of the service worker is to be completely asynchronous, because when you fire all the browser requests into the service worker, they all arrive basically in random order. And if you had a synchronous request that goes to disk and fetches something, you would interrupt the complete process of loading things over the network. So it's simply a performance consideration that these APIs are not exposed. Yeah.
Is that just because you've rewritten it to get a different image? Or would it be possible to say your service worker will intercept the response for an image and then translate the image before giving it to the application?
So that would be a question for Konstantin. I don't know the exact example that he used there. But there's no synchronous API in the service worker. So everything that you can call is always asynchronous. But I think you can discuss it with you. Okay, thank you.